People talk about democracy all the time. Sometimes it's over a beer after a hard day's work. Other times it happens on Facebook. These conversations can be soft or quiet, or loud and animated. But usually they are ephemeral, forgotten shortly after they are held. But other thoughts about democracy can be longer lasting, more carefully thought out and presented, perhaps with an aim to shape the government. Like the U.S. Constitution, or maybe Karl Marx's Das Kapital, which combines the economic and the political. But many times, writers do not want to dictate democracy, but just to think about what it might mean. And those often take the form of fiction, novels, short stories, and so on. And here's where our next speaker comes from. Scott Henkel has a PhD in Literatures of the Americas from Michigan State University, and he uses literature to study how people have organized themselves and how they have thought about organizing themselves in the last couple of centuries. A recent addition to UW's English department faculty, we are already benefiting from his wisdom and his wit. Through literature, Professor Henkel has looked at Haiti and the foundation of a nation from its roots in slavery. He has studied how labor movements have formed and how they govern themselves. The books he analyzes have led Scott towards key topics that we debate regularly within our country. He's analyzed the role of free speech and censorship. He's studied representative democracy as practiced in our nation, as well as direct democracy, both as a type of government and decision-making and as a mode of leadership. Indeed, one of his recent articles on direct democracy has overtones of Star Trek's Borg. His title is, "There Are 2,000 Leaders, the Swarm as a Metaphor for Collective Action." Today he's going to lead us through a quest of thought and imagination about how we can govern ourselves and how we have governed ourselves and how we might govern ourselves in the future as he explores the topic, democracy's past, democracy's future, problems and possibilities. Professor Henkel.
Good morning. Thank you for having me. I appreciate your hospitality. Indeed, the title of my talk today, Democracy's Past, Democracy's Future, Problems and Possibilities. I want to give you the big idea right away. And it's this. Just one. We often think of democracy as a form of government, and it's a perfectly reasonable interpretation to have. But we can also think of democracy as a type of power. And this power has implications for all of our lives, as I hope to show you. What I'd like to do is take you on a tour with three parts. The first part, a globetrot of some of the world's languages, in order to set up our ideas and give us some of the terms that we'll use to talk about. The second part is a trip back to the 19th century to show an example of what could have been. And then the last part will be a jump ahead to the 24th century. Paul mentioned Star Trek, so here it comes. A jump ahead to the 24th century to give you an example of what could be. So to put that another way, I'm going to talk to you first as a scholar of language. I'm going to talk to you second as a historian. And third, I'm going to talk to you as a science fiction geek. It'll be fun, I promise. We have about an hour together, and my plan is to spend about half of that talking, and then we can spend the second half of that in conversation and questions. But like we did before, if you want to stop me any point along the way, please do so, and I'm happy to clarify. I'm happy to answer any questions, anything that you would like. I also want to say that late October, November, I gave a Saturday U talk in Gillette that I see as sort of like the cousin to this talk. It begins with some of the same ideas, but that talk went off in this direction, whereas the talk that I'm going to give today goes off in a different direction. So if there's anything that I say that interests you, I invite you to go to the Saturday University YouTube channel where you can see that other talk. Okay? So, let's start our tour. A globetrot of some of the world's languages. Our modern English word democracy comes from the Greek, and it suggests a situation where a demos, which means people, have kratos, which means power, rule, or authority. And this is where we get the two interpretations of democracy. The big idea that I gave away right away, if we follow the etymology of the words, from people through rule and authority, that leads to questions of government. So a democracy is a situation in which the people rule. But if we follow the etymology the other way, demos plus kratos in the terms of power, the question becomes, what power do we have? I start with the word because I'm an English professor and words are my tools. But words get us to interesting places. They help us to ask some of the good questions and they help us to think analytically about some of the problems that we have. So, for example, from the word democracy, we can think at least theoretically that it's distinct from an aristocracy, from the Greek aristos, which means best, plus kratos, power, rule, and authority. An aristocracy is where the best people rule, the best people have power. Democracy from the word also means it's distinct from a bureaucracy. It's a good one, isn't it? From the French word bureau, so a bureaucracy is where who rules?
Nobody.
Nobody, yeah, yeah, or maybe everybody. But a bureaucracy is where people at desks rule. Democracy also theoretically distinct from a plutocracy. From the Greek plutos, P-L-O-U-T-O-S, is where the rich rule, or those who have wealth rule. And also one more example, because I think it's fun. A democracy is also theoretically distinguished from a bestiocracy. Do you have any guesses as to what that might be? Wow! All of you get it. You are smart. Usually it takes a little while for people to get it. A bestiocracy isn't where the best people rule. That's an aristocracy, as we talked about a second ago. A bestiocracy is, in fact, where the animals rule. In practice, however, we know that these questions are harder, right? It's not as if once we can theoretically make democracy distinct from a plutocracy or a bureaucracy or even a bestiocracy, it's not always so easy to see the distinctions between those two things, right? So this leads us to some of the hard questions. To what degree, for example, in the United States, do the people rule? To what degree do the best people find themselves in positions of political power? To what degree do the rich rule? Do we treat our animals well enough so that they don't rise up and overthrow us and form their own bestiocracy like they do in Orwell's Animal Farm or they do in the Planet of the Apes movies? That last question was probably a joke. But the, but the other questions are pretty serious ones, right? And I have to say they're just the tip of the iceberg. We'll get into some of this as we go along, but some of these hard questions are what I hope we talk about today. So on the questions of democracy as a form of government, in the first interpretation, there we have it. Democracy in the second interpretation, where we follow demos through kratos as a form of power, the questions are different, but they're no less hard. One of the things that makes it hard is that English only has one effective word for power. We have things like force, which usually means physical force or like a problem for physics, right? But in English, we only have one word for power, whereas other languages have two or more. So, for example, in Latin, it has potentia and potestas. French has puissance and pouvoir. Haitian Creole has puissance and pouvoir. Spanish has fuerza and poder. German has Macht, Gewalt, and Vermögen. Generally speaking, the words in the first column mean an innate form of power. This is the power to do things. This is our capacity to learn. This is our capacity to strive, to grow. This is the power that we have in our brains and our muscles. It's innate to the body. We all have different capacities. We can explore our capacities in different ways, all of us. But the first mode of power is intrinsic to us. The words in the second column, we would say in English, are like power over. It's a relationship of power. So, to teach someone else, to mentor someone else, to guide, to parent someone else, but also the power to overpower someone, to dominate them, to control them. So, for example, one of my heroes, Muhammad Ali. Here on our right, you see him using his intrinsic power of intellect to be a mentor, to be a teacher, to be a good example. On the left, you see him using the intrinsic power of his muscles and his brain to dominate another fighter. Now, what these pictures also show is that these two forms of power are different, but it's often hard to make a distinction between them, right? The power that's in our brains and the power that's in our muscles either can be used to develop ourselves or it can be used in relation to other people. Intrinsically, these two types of power are neither good nor bad. It's just part of our human condition. These are the things that we do. We have capacities of our own, and we come together on a Saturday to be in a nice classroom and learn something together. We both have intrinsic powers, and we relate to one another. How we use those powers is a very hard question. I probably don't have to tell you. There are ethical uses of these powers, and there are unethical uses of these powers, and the distinction between those two things is not trivial. But even though it's difficult sometimes, to make a distinction between these two forms of power, I think it's important to insist on the distinction between them. Otherwise, we could easily be persuaded by the idea that just because someone else has more power than we do, that we have none. It's a hard concept, but there are no situations in which people are powerless. There are many situations, however, where other people, other institutions, other groups have more power than we do. It's a hard thought, and to illustrate it, I want to take you on the next step of our tour. Back to the 19th century, in the years after the Civil War. What I'm going to talk about in this part of our tour is one of my favorite books, W.E.B. Du Bois' book, Black Reconstruction in America. Reconstruction generally refers to the period directly after the Civil War, somewhere around 1863 to 1877. And Du Bois' book, which was written in 1935, still, in my judgment, is one of the best contributions to the history of this period. I show this image because it gives a nice circle. From enslavement, through abolition and emancipation, to some of the things that were built after the Civil War. It's hard to see. This says public school. And it's also hard to tell, but this is a voting booth. And of course, an image of the family in the middle. So Du Bois' book was about how slavery was abolished, and then the attempts to reconstruct both the federal government and the various state governments after the war, about the roles that recently emancipated slaves played in those attempts, and also, ultimately, the repression of those attempts, what Du Bois calls, quote, the movement back towards slavery, unquote. In short, the promise of Reconstruction after the Civil War is a lesson in what could have been. That it was repressed is a tragedy for which we're still paying the price. The central problem, as Du Bois writes, was slavery and its abolition. Quote, those 4 million souls whom the nation had used and degraded, and on whom the South had built an oligarchy, erected on cheap colored labor and raising raw material for manufacture. The result was war, because the moral wrong, the economic disaster, and the democratic contradiction of making human labor real estate, unquote. That moral wrong caused a war that left much of the United States in tatters. And the task of rebuilding it wasn't only about bricks and mortar, but it was also about building a new nation that many people hoped would be more equal and more free. The people in this era produced some of the innovations and institutions that we now think of as fundamental to our democracy. So, the abolition of chattel slavery is perhaps the biggest example, perhaps one of the greatest advancements in all of human history. But not only that, in the years after the Civil War, things happened like the formation of the state of Wyoming, which was the first international polity to recognize a woman's right to vote. Not only that, but the Moral Land Grant Acts were passed, for example, that led to the establishment of public schools like the University of Wyoming, and also led to outreach programs like this very lecture. Not only that, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments were passed, abolishing slavery, guaranteeing citizenship, and guaranteeing the right to vote. The issue, however, is that Reconstruction faced intense hostility. At considerable length, I mean, Du Bois' book, Black Reconstruction, is this doorstopper of 746 pages. I would have brought my copy with me, but it would have like doubled the volume of the luggage that I had to bring up from Laramie. So go to your library, go check it out. It's well worth your time. But over considerable length, Du Bois shows how the promise of Reconstruction and the hopes of Reconstruction ultimately were defeated. It took a mix of propaganda, political cowardice, and ultimately physical violence to beat Reconstruction. As Du Bois writes, quote, Reconstruction failed because it was overthrown by brute force. Perhaps the final act in the end of Reconstruction came at the turn of the 20th century in an event that is unfortunately not very well known. Coup d'etat here in the United States in Wilmington, Delaware, in which a multiracial elected government of that city was overthrown and replaced by a new government that explicitly advocated white supremacy. Consider one example of why this is important to us. As I said a second ago, the abolition of chattel slavery is one of the great advancements in all human history. The legal vehicle for doing so was this, the 13th Amendment to the US Constitution. Which reads, "Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States or any place subject to their jurisdiction." The issue comes here in the second clause of this first sentence, except as a punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted. So think about that for a second. It's not that the 13th Amendment is the only law that we have regarding slavery or more modern forms of slavery. But look at the language closely. Does the language of the 13th Amendment abolish slavery universally in the United States? No. Right? So the trouble is, a law that was intended to be emancipatory came to be used in ways that were contrary to its purpose. Right? During the Reconstruction era, the decades after the Civil War, what happened was many laws throughout the United States, not just in the South, were passed criminalizing forms of poverty. So criminalizing vagrancy, right? The population of recently emancipated people were made to have work permits, and if they were found anywhere without a work permit, that became a crime. And what happened? It didn't happen all at once. It didn't even happen evenly over time. But what happened was, over the decades, all of the labor that had previously been performed by enslaved people came to be done largely by convicts. And this is what leads us. Did any of you see a copy of this morning's USA Today? I will leave that floating out there for some of you to see what is on the cover of today's USA Today, something you can think about afterwards. But one of the things that leads us to is the prison explosion of our day. Right? Right now, the United States has approximately 5% of the world's population, but the United States also has approximately 25% of the world's prisoners. What that means is that in the United States today, there are approximately 7 million people under some form of carceral control, from probation all the way up to the federal penitentiary. How this happened and why is a complicated story, right? It has many facets, some of which I'll talk about now, but others of which we can talk about in the question and answer period. But one thing that I think is very relevant is that the story is partially about the anti-democratic use of bigotry and fear. So, for example, the architects of the Wilmington coup in 1898 explicitly used the fears of working class whites against the recently emancipated slaves. They said, in effect, those people are going to take your jobs. You ought to be afraid of them. When people can be made to fear losing what they have, and when they can be persuaded that someone who has even less is the person who poses that threat, it gives the opportunity for someone to come along and exploit that fear. And the beneficiary of exploiting fears is almost never the people who are fearful. It's almost always the people who exploit the fears. So that's a lesson for us. Fear has a way of removing our reason. To remember that, I think, is important. Our neighbors are not our enemies. Immigrants are not our enemies. To analyze that fear and to analyze the people who prey on that fear, I think, is one of the best lessons of the Reconstruction era. There are also many better ways to use the power that we have, the capacity of our brain, the capacity in our muscles. And to illustrate that, we go to the last step on our tour. We jump from the 19th century to the 24th century. We go from an example of what could have been to an example of what could be. Okay? This leads us to the Starship Enterprise, to Captain Picard and Commander Riker, to the android Lieutenant Commander Data. And what I'm going to show you in a second is a clip from an episode in which people from our century, they get cryogenically frozen, and then they wake up in the 24th century. So imagine yourself just like picked up and plopped down into a world that came out of our world, but wasn't our world, right? And the gist of the episode is, what do these people do when they get there? How do they cope with their new situations? Before showing the clip, though, let me set it up a little bit further. In our world, there is a branch of what I think to be really interesting research on what people are calling a post-scarcity society. And what that is a fancy word of basically two words, of saying, what would be the result if our material needs were met? Okay, what would be the result if everyone on the planet had sufficient food, clothing, and shelter? What would that world look like? That's the world of the 24th century. But for us, it's this huge question. We have one example that I'll show you in a second, but what that will actually look like is a pretty hard question. And before you think that's too far-fetched, let me tell you a couple things. It's pretty commonly accepted that right now the Earth produces enough food to feed everyone. It's not that our problem is in production, our problem is in distribution. Okay? Consider a second thing. As Amnesty International reports, in 2011, there were approximately 3.5 million homeless people in the United States, about 8% of whom are veterans. Simultaneously, there are about 18.5 vacant housing units. So houses, apartments, shelters of some adequate kind that are now sitting empty.
With how many?
3.5 million homeless people, about 8% of whom are veterans, and approximately 18.5 million vacant housing units. Oh, did I misspeak? Okay, sorry, my apologies. Yeah, I had to work really hard. So English professors, we like letters and words, right? So I had to work really hard to memorize the numbers. I just missed it, sorry. Indeed, 3.5 million homeless, 18.5 million vacant shelters, right? So think about those two facts. I mean, this is a 1-2 punch of historic proportions. The ability to end hunger and homelessness, not in the 24th century, but in the 21st. Now listen, I'm not saying it's easy. What I'm saying is we have it within our capacity. One more thing. As I show you the clip, what they have on the Enterprise. Do you watch the show? How many people do you see? A couple. Okay, good. So on the Enterprise, they have this device called a replicator, right? It's in the wall, and you go up and you say something like, "Give me a hamburger," and then you're right. It gives you, it produces the food, it produces the clothing, it produces the tools that they use on the Enterprise, and I think that's really interesting. But what I think is even more interesting is that the characters on Star Trek are adamant that it's not the technology that makes the difference between a world without hunger and a world with hunger. It's the values that went with it, right? They practice a certain amount of self-restraint, which is interesting, and we can talk about it a little bit. And one last thing, you know, on the replicator, I don't know how definitively I would like to say the following, but did you see the news from a few years ago that the folks at NASA emailed a wrench up to the International Space Station, and in the space station they printed that wrench on a 3D printer? You saw this? Yeah. Neat, huh? Right? So, is the replicator of the 24th century, right, is that where our 3D printers are going to be 300 years from now? I mean, I don't know, right? It's a question. I'm not making any predictions, because you know how predictions turn out. But it's interesting that one of the things that we first imagined in fiction now turns out to be part of the reality of our world, which I think is totally interesting. Okay, so the idea of the post-scarcity society extrapolates out from facts like these, okay? If we can look at trends, if we can look at facts and perhaps where they're going, we can predict to some small degree, I mean, maybe not a great degree, but we can predict to some small degree about where things might go, okay? But the counter-argument to what I said a second ago is some people out there say that, well, if we didn't have to work for our food, if we didn't have to work for our clothing, if we didn't have to work for our shelter, would we all just like sit around and drink martinis and watch TV all day? You know, laziness leads to societal collapse, and who wants that? So something that turned out to look good at the beginning might turn out to be something very bad for us in the end. I mean, I don't know. If all my material needs were met, I mean, I might lay on the couch for a couple weeks, right? I mean, I work hard, and I know that you work hard too, and maybe having a nice vacation over a couple weeks might be something that would be good for us all. But what happens after that, right? After you had a nice long rest, if you, like me, might want a nice couple of weeks on the couch, what would you do after that? That's the question. Let's see how they deal with it in Star Trek, and then we'll come back and talk about it. I think that exchange is really insightful. Mr. Offenhaus, the man from the 24th century, I think asks a question that ought not to be mocked. I think that's a serious question, right? So what's the challenge? What to do, right? In a situation where our needs are met, honestly, what would we do? And it's easy to say, well, you know, those people over there, they would be lazy, they wouldn't do anything, they would be grifters on the system, whatever. I mean, those people over there, they're the problem. What would you do? How would you develop yourself? How would you enrich yourself? If you were Mr. Offenhaus, deposited into the 24th century, would you learn a new skill? Would you learn a new language? To play an instrument? What would you do? These are not trivial questions. And they're also not just questions for the 24th century. They're questions for the 21st century as well, for our century. So as I said at the top, what I hope you take away from this is the big idea. Democracy not just as a form of government, but also democracy as a form of power. Perfectly reasonable interpretations, both of them. But one issue is when we think of democracy as only a form of government, it can seem very far off. It can seem something very distant, something that happens on the other corner of the state, something that happens two time zones away, and not very relevant to how we live our lives. But democracy is a form of power, a form of power that's here and here, and not just in me, but also in you. That might be something that's hidden in plain sight, and now that you recognize it, I hope you remember it. Thank you. I also have the very last thing, rather than a bibliography, right? What I have is fascinating further reading. This is a list of books and essays that helped me think about how I was going to prepare this talk. Du Bois's Black Reconstruction in America is the book that I talked about in the middle part of the talk. If you want a very, very excellent examination of the long history of the 13th Amendment, I recommend Ava DuVernay's documentary 13th, which you can find on Netflix. The Economics of Star Trek, which I think is particularly great, and other books that were helpful to my thinking. I'm happy to take your questions. Yes, please.
I know you didn't want to focus on the Reconstruction, but can you give just a couple of more insights into who had the first vision and what was it for Reconstruction and why did that fail?
Yeah. So slavery is an ancient institution, right? The oldest texts we have mention slavery. And one thing that I would say, and I don't think I'm alone among the scholarly community, is that part of what we now think of as conversations about human rights also parallel the long history of slavery. So if you want like a very, very big answer, right, the literature of slavery and the literature of human rights sort of track across a lot of time. Okay, so for is your question about the United States in particular?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. One of the things, so the literature and the scholarship on slavery and abolition is about as big a body of scholarship as anything out there. I mean, it's just voluminously huge. So what I do is, and what most scholars do, is take little chunks out of that very big thing and focus on it. What I focus on, what I think is most interesting, is the efforts of enslaved people to free themselves, right? One of the big narratives that we have is the Civil War as told through President Lincoln. Excellent, right? The Civil War as told through elected officials like Thaddeus Stevens. If you want one name to follow up on, Thaddeus Stevens was among the big movers in Congress during the era of the Civil War and Reconstruction, responsible for a great deal of it. And if you saw the recent movie, what's the Lincoln movie about the passage of the amendment, Thaddeus Stevens is played by Tommy Lee Jones, very good, right? Which is interesting because Tommy Lee Jones' portrayal of Stevens is different from how Stevens, in much of the literature and film of the 20th century, is cast as a villain. And what Lincoln does in the film, right, Tommy Lee Jones, let's say, well, what Tommy Lee Jones does is sort of talk back against some of that history and show him as more of a hero. So for me, in particular, what acts did enslaved people take in order to free themselves? What did they do? Did they slow down their work? Did they try to break their tools? Did they run away to slavery to start other communities, right? There's this whole range of things that enslaved people did in order to make problems for the institution of slavery. And that's also the perspective that W.E.B. Du Bois takes, right? He tells the story of the Civil War and Reconstruction mostly through the efforts of formerly enslaved people and then also some of the black legislators during Reconstruction.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
What's the status of indentured servitude now?
Yeah. The question was, what's the status of indentured servitude, right? So, a hard question and a good question. And you mean in, do you mean to imply in the world in which we live right now?
Primarily, yes.
Yeah. A very good question. As I said a second ago, slavery is an ancient institution. And one thing that's important to recognize, I think, is that it's not the same thing over all of that history, right? It evolves, it changes, it adapts, as also does the resistance to it, right? So indentured servitude in our world, human trafficking in our world, continues to be a gigantic problem, right? My area is in the 19th century, so I can't quote you the numbers, but I think with a good afternoon in your public library or with a Google search, you can probably find some surprising things about what some people would call slavery by another name or modern indentured servitude, right? So people who do dirty jobs that we all need. Who grows the food? Where did our clothes come from? Looking at the conditions of people who work in those type of jobs, is it the exact same thing as 19th century chattel slavery? No. Does it have some of the same features? Many people would say yes. Work for very low wages that are insufficient to sustain oneself, right? Some people pay great fees in order to migrate. Fees that they're never able to pay off and therefore become indentured. It's a huge problem. You have a question too?
What was the Delaware coup, I think you called it? When was that?
Yeah. 1898 in Wilmington, North Carolina. Did I say Wilmington, Delaware?
Yeah.
You think I get the words right. The numbers, we could yes, Wilmington, North Carolina. Wilmington, North Carolina. It's the subject, what I should have added it to my fascinating further reading here, but probably the book, the fictionalized account of the Wilmington coup is a book by Charles Chestnut called The Marrow of Tradition. And basically what happened was a group of folks who used to control the city and continued to control the newspaper generated a tremendous amount of propaganda that then led to a race riot. And what happened at the end of the race riot was they used that as an opportunity to oust the current government and install themselves. Yeah, the book is called Marrow of Tradition.
So
by Charles Chestnut.
What was the primary power behind that?
Yeah. There was, I forget the names, there was a group, one was the editor of the newspaper, one I believe was the former mayor, there was a group of nine people, I believe, did much of the agitation. Yeah. There's a Wikipedia page for it. But The Marrow of Tradition is the book that's probably the best source for it.
I have trouble understanding how that led to a change in the government by just those people. I mean,
yeah.
Wasn't there some kind of congressional action that had to occur?
Yeah. For much of Reconstruction, the federal government made it its job to protect the new multiracial governments in the states. But after 1877, the federal government withdrew that protection. And that's why many people date 1877 as the end of Reconstruction. So what happened locally could no longer be protected by the federal government. And that led to the coup. What happened locally was the end of the story.
Was that prompting just a shift in the political winds at that time?
Yeah, by 1898, the political winds had pretty much shifted already. And perhaps that's another way to answer your question. Most historians date the end of Reconstruction to 1877 when federal troops pulled out of the South. Okay, so by the time we get to 1898 in the Wilmington, North Carolina coup, right, local officials could pretty much do what they wanted and count on the federal government not getting involved. Yes.
Was the, I think it was the 13th Amendment, was that ever used against anybody except the blacks? The people enslaved because of a crime?
Yeah.
Was it ever used for other whites?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely. So it wouldn't be fair to say that the emancipated, the population of emancipated people were the only ones affected by, let's call it, the new and nefarious use of the 13th Amendment. They were the primary population. But when one makes laws that criminalize poverty, one isn't only going to catch people of color, right? You're going to catch other people too.
But sometimes laws like that are enforced and sometimes not.
That's very good. Yeah, that's exactly right. That's very right. Sometimes laws are enforced, sometimes they aren't, and the selections between those things is very hard, right? So, for example, the Reconstruction Amendment that guaranteed the right to vote after Reconstruction was not enforced until we get to the latter parts of the 20th century.
And even women.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's exactly right.
Even though it said it.
Even though it said it. Yeah, that's right. That's right. It would be an interesting... It would be an interesting study to go through some state or some federal government body of laws and to see which laws are enforced vigorously, which laws aren't very enforced, and which laws aren't enforced
barely.
Yeah.
That would be
a very interesting study. Yes, please.
I'm not sure what this gentleman was getting at, but your use of the word coup, when I think of a coup, I think of, you know, the military coming in and the general taking over.
Yeah.
So when you talk about a coup in Wilmington, North Carolina, did the National Guard come in and kick the people out?
Yeah, there were national...
A referendum, or was there a new election?
There was no referendum. There was no new election. It was...
How did they do it?
Yeah, there were militia troops there, and there were also armed rioters there. So the physical mechanism for removing the elected government was mostly a riot, armed rioters and militia people.
Was that National Guard or State Guard?
I believe it was State Guard, but check that.
You said National
Guard. Yeah, exactly.
How
right.
How do we deal with the Japanese treatment on the West Coast from World War II?
Yeah.
Also like Montana, where the Germans were so badly abused.
Yeah.
Or because they were now aliens.
Yeah. Say your question loud enough for people in the room to hear it, please.
I was just asking about how do we justify at federal level how we treated the Japanese of the West Coast for World War II and how we treated, especially in Montana, the Germans that were now aliens as well.
Yeah. Yeah. The Supreme Court justification was wartime necessitates these kinds of abuses.
Alien and Sedition Acts.
Alien Sedition Acts, yeah, exactly right. Yeah, exactly right. The legal history of the Alien and Sedition Acts come right at the formation of the United States. They go through the early part of the 20th century, and they're the legal precedent for today's Patriot Act. How to justify those things? I can't give you a decision.
There's the emergency federal act, the War Powers Act,
yeah,
that for me as a physician, they could draft me again, because yeah, I am a national treasure.
Yeah, you are a national treasure, I'm sure.
I was.
Yeah, that's right.
Age 6, yeah, past
yeah,
that, so
yeah, that's
now
right.
I'm not.
We can still consider you one. Yeah, how does one justify that sort of thing? How does one come up with a, if the question is, how does one come up with a convincing intellectual justification for that sort of thing? I don't have one. I don't know if one exists other than the big blanket excuse of it's war, therefore extraordinary measures are necessary. And I wonder how many people find that persuasive.
It's still in our blood. We've seen our history that yeah, we haven't changed that much, because now we're looking at this whole immigration.
Yeah. Yeah. Mark Twain says, history doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. Right?
Yeah.
So thinking about a situation that isn't exactly ours. Right? This is one of the uses of history, one of the things that's very important. One of the things that we can do is look back to situations that were similar and try to make better decisions now. Once again, I'm not saying that's easy. All I'm saying is that it's within our capacity. I hope. Other questions? And then I think we have 4 minutes or so?
Yeah. Could I?
Let me, okay, so I saw her hand first, so two more questions in probably the four minutes that we have.
Well, I'd like to respond specifically to that.
Okay, very good. So do you mind if he's going to respond? Please.
We had an event in Gillette just 2 weeks ago, and we had Eric Sandy, who's the head, or former head of the American Studies Department, speak. And he's an expert on Heart Mountain, which is the Japanese internment camp in northwestern Wyoming. And so if you wanted to go and look at the video on the Saturday View YouTube channel or Saturday View website, he can explain there was a military dictum that allowed the military to make choices. So it wasn't part of the civilian law, it was part of the military law. And they made choices that Japanese were dangerous, Germans were not, by and large. And they made up zones where they were dangerous. So the zones of danger were along the coast. And if you live in proximity to the coast, then the Japanese, like many of the Japanese did on the West Coast, then they were moved. So anyway, advertising for Saturday, you go watch Eric Sandy's video.
Very good. And you have a question too.
I don't know quite how to phrase it, but it kind of has to do with his history rhyming. The president's advisor, Steve Bannon, is said to have the goal of deconstructing some of our political, some of our government and reforming it. Is that a form?
Yeah.
I mean, do you see that rhyming?
Yeah, it's a good question. One of the reasons why I study the 19th century is that it's better always to move from fact to judgment than it is, perception of something that might happen, right? But nevertheless, I think it's incumbent on all of us to learn as much as we can about how people have made decisions in historically analogous situations so that we can make the very best decisions in the world in which we live, so that hopefully we can end up in the 24th century with, all the things that they have there.
Martinis
and television. Oh, they don't have television, but they still have martinis. Thank you very much.